Oh, hi. My name is Julian Chambliss. I am professor of history at Rollins College, which is that way. I'm here to talk about superheroes. Hopefully everyone here is a big fan of superheroes. If not, this will go poorly for you. John asked me to talk about superheroes. I've done a TEDx Orlando talk about superheroes. This has the same title, but not the same content. So if you've seen that talk, this will be slightly different. It'll be a lot different, actually. Because it is described as a lecture, I want to warn you ahead of time that, in fact, I do not have a long thing I'm going to read directly to you. So you're going to lose the lecture experience. There will be no test at the end. Instead, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the ideas that I think animate the study of comics for me as a historian and some of the comic studies fields that's developed in the last 30 years in academia. I want to start by asking you to examine a couple of images. Now, this is an image created by artists a couple of years ago. It went around the web a little bit. Iconography here is quite well known. Metropolis is now a well-known city. Who lives in Metropolis? Anybody? Superman. Even Ryan got that right. He doesn't know anything about superheroes. Batman. Okay, people. Batman. Gotham equals Batman. The relationship between these two cities, I think, is instructive in trying to understand, at least for me, how we can conceptualize comic books today here at Litlando. At some level, what you see when you think about Metropolis and Gotham is a bright urban future and a dark urban past. And for me personally, as a historian, I like to think of myself as I do think of myself as an urbanist, and I approach my work through a series of sort of interconnected circles. And so a lot of the work I do is really has its roots in understanding urban process, and that led me to comic pages. And even recently, in the last few years, I really started to think about how to document that process in terms of creating digital installation and exhibitions that sort of capture some of these stories. So in a short phrase, I sometimes say I explore the real and imagined city. And that's a good way to understand the relationship between sort of historical questions around the city and its development and imaginary spaces like comic book pages. And in fact, that inaction process here is urban process shapes and comic pages express and digital spaces document for me. And you can see this as a sort of creative synthesis. There's a reality and symbols that are connected. And so for me, when I look at artifacts of the past, I'm looking to try to understand this process of relationship between the real and the imagined. My initial research really focused on city plans, for instance. The plan of Chicago, the most famous city plan in the United States, was created in 1909. And it's really a way for the people of that period to try to rationalize and bring order to what they experienced in terms of rapid urbanization at the turn of the century. So they created really imaginary spaces. They drew them up. They created great paintings like this of an imagined civic space that would answer the question posed by the rapid transformation at the turn of the century and beginning of the 20th century, the rise of an urban industrial order. This was a tremendous concern. The United States is transforming, is losing its sort of homogeneous agrarian lifestyle and being replaced by a growing urban industrial lifestyle. With that urban industrial lifestyle came concentrations in big cities that were foreign to many of the lifestyle and choices and ideologies that many Americans held dear. These were places where the other outnumbered the native born. Places like New York, Chicago, Boston, they were 50, 60, sometimes 70% immigrant in the early decades of the 20th century. This created tremendous anxiety for a lot of Americans. So it's no surprise that when you look at imaginary landscapes, even something seemingly as disconnected as this, there is connection between that city plan and this character, Captain Marvel, which you might know of as Shazam. His original name was Captain Marvel. That connection is what I want to talk to you about today, because at some very basic level, comic books fall into what I refer to as an assimilative frame. And here, the nature of that assimilative frame is made clear or hinted at from this capture from a television program that's on television right now called The Flash, the CW program. This is based on a classic comic book character called The Flash. And if you know anything about comic book history, or if you watch the show, you know this is Barry Allen and Iris West. In the original comic book, Barry Allen is indeed a white guy, but in the new comic book, in the new television show, Iris West is African-American. She was not in the comic book. This created some tremendous controversy when it was first announced. But in practice, if you watch the show, she's practically white. This is one of the critiques that social critics and cultural critics have leveled against the show. But it's understandable if you understand the root of the comic book form and its goals in trying to like reconcile these anxieties around urbanization and transformation and broad social narratives that Americans hold dear. So when you look at a comic book page, you're really looking at artifacts that are rooted in that transformation. So I'm gonna go back and talk a little bit about that affirmative, assimilative frame, and then talk about how the comic books sort of like negotiate these transformations. So when we talk about comic books, we often talk about them sort of their start point, which is actually the late 30s, 1938. But in particular, to understand comic books, we really have to understand those images and stories that predated in the early decade, early 1930s and the late 1920s. These are actually represented by something called the pulp magazines. The pulp magazines actually have a lot of proto-superheroes, what like scholars like to refer to as proto-superheroes. A character like the Shadow, who you see here, is famous for his ability to cloud men's minds. He was the subject of a not bad movie starring Alec Baldwin a few years ago. Like it was more like 20 years ago now. But you also had characters like Doc Savage, the Man of Bronze, and even earlier characters like Nick Carter, who's a kind of analog, a kind of contemporary to Sherlock Holmes. He was sort of an American version of the Sherlock Holmes, a sort of detective that worked in the city. These characters brought together many of the concerns associated with this transformation that I mentioned before, the move from a rural homogeneous society to an urban cosmopolitan society. Actually, the move in the United States from a sort of insular country to a country that's facing global and engaging in global trade, having people from the other parts of the world come to it, and having to negotiate that. When you look at these characters, you can see many of these concerns playing themselves out in the most popular forms, in the most popular characters that emerged in the period. One example of this has to do with the transformation associated with the cowboy. In many ways, the cowboy is the first and perhaps one of the most iconic characters of the pulp literature. The cowboy story really is a kind of way for Americans to conceptualize the transformation that was taking place at the end of the 19th century. And one of the things that happens in those stories is that the actually multicultural cowboy reality is whitewashed and transformed into a primarily white assimilating manifest destiny story. And a prime example of this, and there are many examples of this, but one of the prime examples of this is Deadeye Dick, because there are so many Deadeye Dick pulp stories that are written. In reality, the character, the man who is the basis of Deadeye Dick, is a guy named Nat Love, who's a mulatto African-American cowboy. He won, in fact, this great cowboy contest in Wyoming. He won the shooting contest, he won the riding contest. He mastered all the cowboy skills. But when his persona is transformed in the stories, he's rewritten as a white guy. And in many ways, many of the cowboy population of the late 19th century were, in fact, Mexican. They were, in fact, there were Chinese cowboys, a large percentage of cowboys that were African-American. But as Americans are making this transition to the 20th century, they're romanticizing the Western experience, and they're eliminating any role for people of color. So that assimilative process pushes to the boundaries the actual multicultural past and replaces it with a more white, a more sort of middle class version of the past that's really engaging for people. So that process takes on more and more symbolic power as more and more archetypes are created in the pulp magazines. So a prime example of this is Conan. I use Conan because everyone knows Arnold Schwarzenegger, right? Yeah, Arnold, right? He's very famously made two Conan films in the 1980s. His Conan, not exactly like the Conan from the Pulse, but Conan was in fact one of the most popular characters in the pulp era. And if you think about it, and I often describe this to students, the Conan story is a story that very much jives with those broad narratives of transformation and assimilation that people are articulating in the period. In particular, Robert E. Howard, the man that created Conan, actually came up with an elaborate prehistory of the world that Conan lived in. Conan himself was from the north and he ventured into the South in search of adventure. The original stories were told in a kind of broken timeline, but they were very quickly by publishers reoriented into like a kind of Horatio Alger-esque transformation timeline. So he comes from the North, goes into the South, goes to the city basically, has a bunch of adventures, and eventually becomes king. In many ways, he runs into allegories of peoples of color from around the world in his adventures. But Conan's natural sort of inherent values, his natural strength, his natural sort of code of honor overcome whatever the problems he may face from the other. And like many of these characters, he has helpers who are people of color, who might be experts in sort of specialty fields. He has a witch doctor friend. He has a sort of like strong sort of former slave friend. There's another character that Robert E. Howard created called Solomon Kane, who has a witch doctor friend. But each one of these characters are basically helpers that are helping to affirm Conan's sort of eventual success as a civilizing force in society. Because he will eventually become king in one of these sort of decaying kingdoms that he comes into in the South. So this story really becomes a kind of parallel to a basic Horatio Alger story. Remember, it's a young man from the country that goes to the city and cleans up the city and makes it better, makes it stronger, makes it achieve the values that it's supposed to achieve. Those ideas really don't ever go away. And as we transition into the creation of the superhero, the first character is created really crystallizes this idea in a way that's powerful for the audience at the time. Superman, of course, is the first superhero created by Siegel and Shuster, Jared Siegel and Joe Shuster. In many ways, this is a character that takes many of the elements that have been presented in the pulp in the first sort of 20 years and crystallizes into like one single character. He evolves in certain ways, but in many ways affirms many of the tropes that are already existing. And his origin story really makes this clear. If you say it out loud, it becomes painfully clear. Remember that Superman is actually named Kal-El. He's an alien that comes to the United States as a very young child. Now, alien at the time is another word for immigrant. It's immigrant alien. He grows up in the country, so he gets all the values associated with like rural life that's infused into him. And then when he grows up, he goes to the city, and then with a combination of the values he learned in the country and his innate immigrant traits, he's able to make his community better. This is a great pro-immigrant, pro-assimilative message that many Americans believe. They had a short term, sort of like shorthand for it, they called it the melting pot, but then in reality, that idea of transformation associated with the loss of otherness, but the sort of affirmation of the core American values is very strong. But with Superman, there's more going on than just simply that story as well. He's introduced at a period where the United States is in actually great turmoil. The Great Depression has been very difficult for the United States. It is in the 1930s that we have the highest level of Americans that are members of the Communist Party. The emergence of the New Deal, sort of championed by FDR, is supposed to address some of the structural inequities that many Americans believe exist in the social order. So when you look at it that way, not only is Superman both a kind of immigrant story, but he's also a New Deal hero because his first stories are him correcting structural problems. He beats up a crooked mine owner. He goes after crooked politicians. He terrorizes failed union bosses. He prevents gamblers who are taking advantage of the weak. The Superman that we know, the Superman that's matured 80 years later, is not the Superman of the 1930s and 1940s. That Superman is a Superman of the New Deal. That Superman is a man of the people who is, and sometimes brutal in his way that he attacks the power elite. So this character, in some ways, suggests the American experience is in fact on track, that the New Deal and all that it represents are going to fix the sort of structural problems associated with the United States. This is the first superhero. This is the archetype that many other characters will follow. But it's important to recognize that the second superhero might be argued is a reactionary character. Batman actually goes back into the sort of reservoir of the pulp characters, and you have an urban detective who's very much a vigilante in the same way that the cowboy had vigilance committees and posses that rode out and administered justice. Here you have a singular figure, an ancestral figure, whose family owns the city that he lives in. In very real way, it's one of the first families of the city, who lives outside the city. But at night, when things are troubled, he suits up, rides into the city, and administers justice. In many ways, that idea is incredibly regressive. He is a character that is primarily Anglo-Saxon. We know from sort of like research that he's probably Episcopalian. That he rides into the city and he's administering justice in communities and spaces that are probably primarily immigrant. Again, when you look at the first stories, the first sort of like criminals that Batman is administering, is an odd mix of sort of fantastic horror elements in the stories. He kills vampires and werewolves, and then like straight up mob bosses, right? Like he's attacking the immigrant other. And these are real concerns, of course, for the reader. These are the kind of things that they're afraid of. So you have these two very, very different ideas presented in the first two characters that create the superhero. One, a kind of positive, affirmative immigrant idea. The other, a kind of reactionary, questioning guardian figure. And these two become the archetype because every character thereafter is either Superman-ish or they're Batman-ish. That's it. Right, you can think about any character you pick is one or the other, Superman-ish or Batman-ish. If you get something in the middle, people can go like, well, that's the Superman crowd, the Batman crowd. But at the same time, of course, this genre, the superhero genre, and it's a new genre, becomes quite popular. And in fact, it starts to ride the wave of American transformation because it comes in the middle of the Great Depression. But the Great Depression is quickly going to come to an end with the rise of global conflict that we know as World War II. And comic books start to reflect those ideas as well. And again, you see characters that are created that really speak to the problems and aspirations and mediations that are coming from the United States as it faces this problem of World War II. Because this cover, very famously, the cover of Joe Simon and Jack Kirby's Captain America number one, happens before the United States is in World War II. This man is punching Hitler in the face before the United States is in World War II. Now, why? Well, we know that, of course, Jewish Americans were well aware of all the horrible things that Adolf Hitler was doing in Germany. We also know there was a period of high anti-Semitism in the United States. People who were trying to leave Germany could not get into the United States. We turned away refugees. We participated in international meetings to perhaps create a temporary home for fleeing Jews in Northern Africa. We did a number of things, but we didn't do the one thing perhaps we wanted to do, which was stand up and say, yes, this is wrong, we will take you. But many of the creators that are creating comic books are in fact Jewish Americans. And their concerns and their awareness of the plight of Jews in Germany come through in the pages of comics like this. So Captain America is punching Hitler in the face before we're in World War II. But very quickly, other comic book characters are going to fall into the same sort of pattern as World War II transforms the United States and actually gets us out of the Great Depression. The war period is important because the war period is part of that sort of golden age of comic books. When we talk about comic books, we often refer to them in these ages. The first age is the Golden Age, which is the sort of like foundation period, 1938, and goes through the 1940s. In this period, you see a number of characters that are created, but they're either Superman-ish or they're Batman-ish, right? There are some variations, but they're basically Superman-ish or they're Batman-ish. But many of them are often in this period patriotic. These are companies that you've never heard of. I'd be shocked if you had heard of it. But this is one of the most famous ones, American Best Comics. Now these characters are in the public domain. But as you can see, these are characters, they're taking a beach, right? They're fighting a war. This was not uncommon in this period to see these cover images of characters sort of involved in World War II. But the stories never did that. The stories rarely ever did that. The actual comic book pages, they did not have the characters actually fighting to sort of like in Hitler's reign. that wasn't the case. But he often had these covers that referenced the fact that the war was going on. It's also important to remember when we talk about the comic book industry at this time period, it's an incredibly diverse industry. This is a kind of capture of the newsstand in December 1942. And what you can see is there's a number of different kinds of comics, Archie, Captain Marvel, Champ Comics, comedy comics. In fact, the comic book medium had many different genres. Superheroes were just one. And comic books sold in the hundreds of millions every month in the 1940s, right? Literally 100 million comic books might be sold in a given month. So this is a vigorous landscape, and the superheroes is one important part. They're sort of like processing the war. But you have other characters that emerge in other publications that speak to a kind of diverse landscape around comic books. For instance, this is very famously an all-Negro comics, which is created by an African-American creators in Philadelphia, is a comic anthology that presents characters that are drawn from many different sort of like story forms. You have a detective character, you have a character called Lion Man, you have comedy stories. Only one issue was produced, but it's an example of how diverse the comic book landscape could be. Also in this period, you see the emergence of a female superhero created by William Marston. Wonder Woman first appears in Sensational Comics. This is a character created by the creator as a way to sort of like empower women and teach men about the need to sort of like submit and sort of like curtail their aggressive tendencies. Marston had a very complicated lifestyle. He was involved in a polyamorous relationship with his wife and his girlfriend. He had kids with both. Like, he's also the guy that came up with the lie detector. So some of the elements of Wonder Woman's powers actually references on expertise in terms of like lie detectors and something like that. So the lasso of truth and so on and so forth. You ever see pictures of him with his wife and his assistant slash girlfriend? She wears bracelets, his girlfriend. So Wonder Woman has these bracelets. And he believed in being sort of, he believed in what we would understand to be a kind of like bondage-ish thing. So that's why Wonder Woman gets often tied up a lot in the first stories, right? But he actually talked about this very, very seriously as a way to teach men about relinquishing power to women. Like, Wonder Woman is a super strong character designed for boys to read, so they would be willing to like submit to women. We can only guess how much submission he might have been involved with. But Wonder Woman, All Negro Comics, these are examples of the diversity of comic books in this golden age period. Even The Spirit, which is created by Will Eisner. Eisner is a creator. He had his own studio. He produced a number of comic products for other companies. But in The Spirit, he wanted to create a character that would appeal more to adults, right? He wanted to create a more sophisticated kind of comic book character. So he creates a newspaper reporter that's killed, that comes back to life. He has a domino mask, and he wears a suit. That's The Spirit. But in the pages of The Spirit, first as a newspaper strip and then as a comic book, he pioneers many innovative elements, incorporating understanding of film theory, panel layout, different kinds of transitions in stories, and so on and so forth. He's a big advocate very early on that comic books as a form can be more sophisticated. They're not just for kids, because he, in fact, had been brought up and had worked in newspaper comic strips, were usually associated with more adult content, more adult readership. He wanted to make sure that did not go away. And in fact, he will be a strong proponent of comic books as a more sophisticated form throughout his career. And we'll talk more about him later. Comic books are incredibly successful, but there's no question the most successful character in this golden age is probably Superman. So he's one of the first characters to be adapted to other media. We'd like to think of like a contemporary period where we have a lot of comic book movies as like the first adaptation. But in fact, one of the things that we talk about openly in scholarly circles is that, you know, there's actually a kind of mediation associated with these characters versus pulp characters and comic book characters from the beginning. Some of those mediations are incredibly problematic. I'm gonna show you one. This is a capture of the Fleischer Studios Superman cartoon from the 1940s.
Amazing powers in a never-ending battle for true justice, Superman justice, Superman has assumed the skies of Clark Kent, mild-mannered.
So the 11th hour, also sometimes referred to as Japaneurs, somewhat racist, but is one of the first examples of Superman being turned into animation by the Flash Studios, which actually operated out of Miami. This was an incredibly popular series. Again, there's many innovations here. Superman had already been a sensation on the radio, already had a huge merchandising army of materials, everything from launch boxes to pens, to paper, and so on and so forth. So this is another example of like them sort of transforming the product and transforming the character to mass appeal. The victory of the United States and the Allies during this period sort of brings a new set of circumstances for comic books. In fact, the superhero comics actually start to tank after the war is over. During the war, lots of soldiers had read comic books, lots of adults were reading comic books, lots of kids were reading comic books. 100 million comic books were being sold in a month. Superman alone sold a million copies a year. But after the war, superhero comics really started to take a dive. But that's okay because new genres emerge, like the romance comic. Strangely enough, the same guy that created Captain America also created the romance genre. Jack Kirby created the romance genre. And this makes perfect sense. We argue about the transformation and the shock of veterans coming back to the United States after having fought in World War II, and significant depression, significant sort of like stress around transition, having fought in the war, sort of been there, and then coming back and being expected to fit into the middle class framework, the sort of domestic framework that's being articulated by the government as part of the post-war transformation in the United States, not just domestically, but internationally. There was great anxiety about this, not just simply for women who were being forced to leave jobs that they acquired and done quite well in during the war, but also for men who, for a variety of reasons, may not have wanted to be in these sort of domestic spheres. And so you see genres that appear that sort of like speak to this transformation. The romance genre is one, but also you see the emergence of something like the horror genre. Horror comics become quite successful after the war. Again, millions of men who'd gone out and fought in horrible battlefields in Europe and Asia are coming back and getting jobs they had before. They're getting jobs in the comic book industry. Many comic book professionals like Jack Kirby were in the war. Stan Lee was in the war. They worked in the war. So the stories they make in the horror comics have a tinge of realism that speaks to the sort of dichotomy associated with the rhetoric of the post-war period versus the reality of how society actually operates. So the horror comics actually often have, we're very famous for having these sort of like somewhat weird idyllic landscapes where something horrible is happening. So yeah, they're on a subway station, there's an arm. But then they have like all these scenes in a middle class neighborhood, but then like in the background of the window, you see a woman like chopping the head off her husband. Stuff like this is a kind of commentary on the tension around transition back. Much like film noir, which we sort of like look back later and realize that was a sort of cinematic narrative that captured some of these anxieties, comics did as well. It was difficult for comic books not to be caught up in this sort of difficult and transformative politics because, of course, after the war, very quickly we fell into a new kind of ideological struggle called the Cold War. That ideological struggle was predicated on the idea of containment. This is a way that academics sort of talk about both the domestic and international effort of the United States to sort of promote security and stability globally. And although it's hard for you to see, this is actually an actual drawing that appeared in a magazine. Watchman's Rounds, 1954, actually shows all the treaties that the United States has signed around the world to prevent the spread of communism. containment meant preventing our former allies, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, the USSR, from spreading its communist influence around the world. The United States was heavily involved in creating the post-war political and economic structure through things like the World Bank, through things like the UN, through things like the Marshall Plan, all of which was diametrically opposed by the USSR, who wanted to create its own sort of sphere of influence. Of course, in the context of the post-war period, we have atomic weaponry, first the United States, and then very quickly the USSR. So our Cold War is not really cold. We call it that because we don't actually ever fight directly with the USSR, but in fact, we have a lot of proxy confrontations around the world. But from a domestic standpoint and an international standpoint, containment is very important. Containment refers to the idea that certain activities, actions, and thoughts are necessary to promote and protect the United States and its allies around the world. If you're not doing those things, you're perhaps not a good American, or worse, you're a spy, and we need to kill you. We don't know. Part of the problem of containment, of course, is that our enemy represents an ideological threat, not necessarily a physical threat, although there is a physical threat. It's tricky, right? Mm-mm. They say they're gonna kill us, and we say we're gonna kill them, but if they try to kill us, we know we can kill them. So it's like mutually assured destruction. So we're probably not gonna kill each other, but we're always thinking about it. Yeah, that gets tricky. So you see the idea of containment filtering through every bit of society. And comic books are no different. Remember, after the war, horror comics and romance comics, they're great. But are those good for kids? This guy, the guy in the corner, Frederick Wortham, says no. They're not good for kids. Wortham was a child psychologist. He had risen to fame, actually doing work for the NAACP. He's the guy who did the experiment with the dolls. He gave dolls to African Americans and asked white and black dolls, asked them which was the good doll, which was the bad doll. Every time they picked the white doll is good and the bad doll is the black doll. He made the argument, well, you know, this is the psychological consequence of racism. He was the only man willing to open a clinic for mental health in Harlem and did so with colleagues. But he was also the guy that said comic books were bad for kids. He said Wonder Woman was weird because she always got tied up, which, you know. He said Batman and Robin, that's not a good relationship. A grown man and a little long boy in tights, come on. Superman's a fascist. Hey, these are not good characters. These are not good ideas. These are not good American ideas. These things should be stopped. I tell you this, Frederick Wortham is not a bad man. Students always go, this is a bad man. I'm like, no, he did that thing in Harlem. He was willing to help people, but he thought comics were bad. He did. The irony here is that all the critiques that Frederick Wortham made about comics, people had made them before. They made every one of them. Yeah, you know, one of them does get tied up a lot. People wrote in. I can show you a letter. How come she gets tied up a lot? And in fact, she gets tied up this way. Why did you tie her up this way? I got 18 different ways you could tie up a girl. Right, there's lots of ways you can tie up a person, right? So, okay, so it's not a new revelation, but in the context of the Cold War, the idea that comics are bad, in fact, become an important sort of touchstone. Remember, we're trying to make society safe for democracy. So rather than be shut down, in fact, the House on Un-American Activities has a hearing where they do bring in comic creators. They create their own sort of regulatory body, and all comics have to fit neatly under the Comics Code. Under the Comics Code, many of the imageries you might have seen in those crime comics or those horror comics or the romance comics, they all have to go away. You can't have characters defy authority. You can't have a criminal get away. You can't have like violent imagery. You get new comics under the Comics Code, and this is all voluntary. The comics publishers fall in line. The comics that are created, however, they have a different feel than previously. They have a different feel. Archie? Without fail, if I ask a student, do you know any comic books, they always say Archie. Damn, even now, Archie. And Batman too transformed. You know, he got Batwoman. They want to make sure that Batman, that question about Batman and Robin was answered. So you brought in Batwoman, brought in Batgirl, they got Bathound, you got the Bathorse, a full family contingent in Batman. But perhaps not as dark and horror and fringe as original Batman. Not the same dark Avenger. This is the comic book landscape of the 1950s that inspires the Batman TV show of the 1960s, right? The sort of campy TV show. But the Silver Age is a sort of transformation that happens. After the comic code, at the end of the 1950s, comic book creators have an opportunity to attract a new generation of readers, and they do so by revamping characters. They do so also with the understanding by this time of the importance of the Cold War. So many of the revamps really fall neatly within the Cold War framework of containment. And you can see this very clearly. For instance, remember that original picture I told you was of the Flash? The Flash, the Silver Age Flash, is actually Barry Allen. But there was an original character, Jay Garrick, that was the Golden Age Flash. So when DC decides they're going to revamp their line, which they're doing right now again, they bring out Flash, but they redesign Flash. They redesign Flash as a police scientist who, instead of like the original Flash, who inhaled heavy water vapor to get his powers, the new Flash gets struck by lightning and doused by chemicals, and that's why he's fast. They also redesign Green Lantern. The original Green Lantern was a magical character. He literally had a lantern, you know, kind of like a green flame. The new Green Lantern is a fighter pilot named Hal Jordan who gets his ring from an alien. He's a policeman. The Green Lantern is reinvented as a police corps. What you see in both of these characters is an adherence to this idea of law and order and values. Many of the Silver Age revamped DC characters are authority figures. They are figures that work for the government or work for the police or work for the military, and they are providing order. They're fighting dangers associated with society. It's very much an affirmation of that Cold War framework. In contrast, Marvel also creates characters in this period. In fact, Marvel is very different from DC in the sense that it very quickly taps into the rising tide of social conflict and social protest that is emerging in the 1960s. So the DC characters are emerging in the late 1950s, and Marvel starts publishing its characters in 1961. So characters like Spider-Man, like Fantastic Four, and like X-Men, all of them tap neatly into the youth culture that's in rebellion, open rebellion in the streets by the time we get to the 1960s. These are characters with problems, with emotions, with sometimes problematic entanglements. The Fantastic Four is very famously referred to as a family drama, and the two kids are Johnny and the Thing, and the parents are Reed and Sue, and they're always fighting, like everybody's family. The X-Men are youth who feel they don't fit into society. They don't fit in because they're mutants, but really millions of American children, a million American teenagers don't feel like they don't fit in, and those same teenagers are gonna read the X-Men. Spider-Man, well, we all know about Spider-Man. He has a whole host of problems, but he always does the right thing. And what the two major publishers, and there are only two major publishers by this time, they really sort of whittled down through the late 40s and the late 50s. What they do is they tap into this Cold War framework and provide different kinds of stories. Because even with these characters, with their emotional entanglement, with their appeal to youth, the Fantastic Four, their first mission, the reason they got into the rockets because they wanted to beat the Russians to the moon, right? Even the X-Men have twinges of Cold War dynamics as their main villain, Magneto, is often seen as a proxy to external threats like the Russians, but also internal threats like Malcolm X, all of which were often seen as communist threats at the time. So at the same time, Marvel is very adept at, as the previous sort of genre has, interpreting contemporary pop culture. So the spy craze in the 1960s and Marvel pages becomes Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., right? And the original Nick Fury doesn't look like Samuel L. Jackson, he's this guy. right? It's a spy story set in a superhero world. Also, of course, they introduce Iron Man as, in some ways, a very different character from all the other characters, but a very much a Cold War character. A weapons maker who goes to Vietnam to test a weapon, who gets captured by a Viet Cong warlord, who builds a suit of armor to free himself, and his first act as a hero is to blow up a Viet Cong base. That is the story of Iron Man. And he decides he's gonna go on being a superhero. And many of his enemies are in fact Cold War analogs. The Black Widow is a spy who's trying to steal things for the Russians. The Crimson Dynamo is an armored alternative to himself, so on and so forth. But there are real transformations taking place in society, and Marvel Comics does reflect them. They introduce a black hero in 1966, not that far after the passage of the Voting Rights Act of 1965, called the Black Panther, not because of the political party. The original name was the Cold Tiger. They decided that wasn't gonna work. They went with the Black Panther. Good for them. There is a big controversy. Do they name it after the political party? Technically, they were first, but I know from research and looking at the newspaper and also looking at where their offices were that they were going through, and they probably saw protests associated with the rise of the Black Panther Party. And there were stories about the Black Panther Party, which actually originates in Mississippi, the iconography of the Black Panther Party originates in Mississippi. So there's a possibility they might have seen it, but technically they were first. But this is a huge, huge deal because there had been no black superhero characters that were not horrible stereotypes. I spared you some of the examples, but there I can show you things like Whitewash Jones or Ebony White, and so on and so forth. But here you have a character who's actually African. Imagine, again, by Jack Kirby and Stan Lee, they imagine an African country, Wakanda, that was never conquered by Europeans. It is both a mix of African iconography, at least how they know it, how they understand it, and super science. So images like this show a kind of what might have been if there had never been any kind of colonial takeover of Africa. Wakanda is led by the Black Panther, and the Black Panther is actually both the spiritual leader and the political leader of the country. He's not wearing a costume. That's just like Pope-like robe. Like it's like if he's the Pope and the president wrapped up into one. And the original story, the one that introduces him, is actually a story of post-colonial narrative, right? He asked the Fantastic Four to help him fight off a Belgian mercenary named Claw who's trying to take over his country. They do, he succeeds. And you have the first black hero, but not the first African-American hero. That comes later. Doesn't matter so much in sense that this is the first character, because in fact there will be other characters that follow, but this is really a marker of the transformation taking place in society that's making its way into comic books and how they're interpreting this. This is actually a dynamic period. By the time we get to the end of the 1960s, there are huge tragedies around civil rights, the death of Martin Luther King, and there are huge protests around Vietnam. This is an incredibly difficult period for the United States, and comic books quickly try to make that transition. Some examples of the sort of complicated social landscape that comic books reflect, on the pages of In the Streets, you have a women's rights movement, and on the cover of Ms. Magazine, Wonder Woman for President. Remember, Wonder Woman was one of the first, she was literally the first superhero. When Ms. Magazine decides they want to put a comic book character on their front page, they choose Wonder Woman, Wonder Woman for President. Ironically, in this same period, the editors and writers at DC Comics actually depowered Wonder Woman. It actually caused great controversy. Gloria Steinem wrote a long essay in the pages of Ms. Magazine complaining about the one strong superhero woman character being depowered. But other more complicated political and social questions were also in the pages of comic books. Without the permission of the Comic Code Authority, Marvel ran a story about drugs and drug addiction in the pages of Spider-Man. And of course, the consequences of Watergate. I'll show you just a little bit of this.
This hour, a select committee of the United States Senate is about to begin public hearings on something called Watergate. 1 year ago today, Watergate was just an address, a rather fancy, expensive address in this capital city. But now it has come to symbolize much more. The word crisis is perhaps too mild to apply to Watergate. President Nixon's White House has been shaken. Indeed, the entire executive branch of the government has been jolted by...
Watergate, of course, plays out when Richard Nixon eventually leaving office. But in the pages of Captain America, the most patriotic of all Marvel superheroes, he gets involved in his own investigation that leads him through a secret conspiracy against the secret empire, and eventually ends up in the White House, and he sees a cloaked figure commit suicide. We can only assume that that cloaked figure is Richard Nixon. After that, Steve Rogers loses faith with the United States and actually gives up being Captain America and goes on and becomes a character called Nomad for a period of months. Another allegory that sort of speaks to the troubled nature of the American political landscape. Comic books do reflect the changing landscapes, as you can see. But by the time we get to the 70s, a more harsh and at some level more adult comic book narrative is starting to make its way into the mainstream. The same people who were protesting in the streets and protesting on campus were also becoming involved in a kind of comic art that has roots in that student protest and anti-war movement. Publications like the Berkeley Barb and the Chicago Seed provided sort of comic and graphic narratives that were critiques of the mainstream and commercialism and some of the expectations associated with quote unquote American empire. These kind of comic book narratives actually were interwoven with the satirical comic book tradition that began in the 1950s as a reaction to the Comic Code and the Comic Book Authority. So Mad Magazine was actually created and after many of those people that were involved in the horror comics couldn't get a job, EC, the publisher that produced horror comics, started publishing Mad, and that became an institution. So this satirical, political tradition really starts to flower in the 70s. And you see the emergence of a kind of underground comics, or comics with an X. Underground comics, comics with an X. And characters like R. Crumb, who creates the Keep on Truckin' symbol. But these also are become the space and opportunity for the creation of really eclectic and serious adult literary themed comic anthologies like Arcade and Raw. People like R. Crumb, people like Paul Kassler, Kurt McDowell, S. Clay Wilson, all of them are going to produce really complicated, sort of satirical, highly political, often sexual content that really spoke to an adult comic audience. This is an important sort of counterpoint because their success as an underground marketplace actually prompts more established comic book creators to try to, again, as they had in the 1940s, attempt to do more. And one of the first people to do this is Will Eisner. He's often credited with creating the first graphic novel with his Contract with God, which is a story, a set of stories that explore the Jewish immigrant experience of his childhood in the tenements. But those transformations in the 1970s do start to run into broader transformations taking place in the United States. By the time we get to the 1970s, the latter part of the 1970s, there's a conservative counter-revolution, arguably, championed by Ronald Reagan. Reagan, who was the governor of California, will run unsuccessfully for president in 1976, but then come back in 1980 and be quite successful. His political landscape, his conservative political landscape, actually celebrates America, celebrates American values, and is quite dismissive of some of the critiques that have been built into society in the 1970s. The 1980s see the return of somewhat regressive characters. Characters like Mike Hammer are really sort of the hardball detective, reinvested and reinvigorated for the 1980s. And then a celebration of excess that you associate with something like Dallas, these become benchmarks of the period. But it's also important to recognize that there's a transformation in comic books that coincide with this period, and then there's a weird synergy here. By the time you get to the end of the 1970s, the direct market has opened up, and this is means that there are specialized comic book shops that are able to sell comic books direct to specialized customers, people who know comics very well. And this opens the door to long-form, individually driven artistic narratives like Cerebus by Dave Sims, He starts this in December 1977, and he goes steady until March 2004. A satirical, political story that stars a kind of aardvark. It touches on religion, politics, so on and so forth. But it's imperative to understand that the direct market, the specialized comic book store, supports this kind of artistry, but it also supports other kinds of artistry as well. The second wave or third wave of Japanese anime and manga coming to the United States, the success of the Akira, which gets its source, one of the first mangas to get a complete run in the United States in its entirety. But that specialized audience in the comic book shop is also an audience that major comic book publishers can throw specialized content at. One example of this is Watchmen, ranked as one of the 100 most important novels of the 20th century. Watchmen originally was a project where the writer and artist Alan Moore and Dave Gibbons were given the job of revamping a series of characters that were purchased by DC Comics. They came in with a treatment. The editors read it and said, we can never, ever, ever, ever sell this. Go back. It's good. Go back. Make some changes and we'll do something with it. They did. They went back and they created Watchmen. And they sold. And this, in fact, created a whole new subgenre, because the graphic novel that was only hinted at with Will Eisner's Contract with God really sort of crystallizes with The Watchmen, because it's collected and sold in bookstores. Another major publication of the same period in the mid-1980s, The Dark Knight Returns, also reinvigorated the Batman imagery, the Batman image, and becomes a bestseller, also sold in bookstores. Even DC, it redesigns its main line and does a crisis where they try to streamline and make things more logical. All of this is incredibly successful. The comic book shops allows for comic book readers who are really at this point an expert audience. They know comic books and they know continuity. And the comic book publishers know that, so they start to create more elaborate comic book stories. The most popular comic book of the 1980s, without question, the X-Men. And that comic book really becomes a space where greater questions of otherness, greater questions of politics, elaborate, sometimes convoluted story plots and characters are introduced. The success of the comic book industry by the end of the 1980s meant that you could find comic books across the United States in bookstores and in comic book shops. In the early 1990s, some of the best artists from all the comic book companies got together and formed their own comic book company called Image. While it was first associated with like big guns and big body parts, by the time we got into the early 2000s, they started supporting independent single author or single artistic team stories like Saga, which is one of the most popular comic books today. At the end of the day, the contemporary landscape around comics remains one that's incredibly complicated, but part of that complication grows from the fact that those classic characters are now being articulated and mediated through various platforms, be it movies, be it television, be it web, be it animation. Here you have a list of all those comic book movies that are coming out. This is an interesting process from a sort of like a scholarly perspective. Point of view, because many of these movies are amalgamating stories and storylines that cover the entire 70 to 80 year history of comic books. So when we're reading or when we're looking at the Marvel Cinematic Universe, you're looking at Iron Man, you can note that that origin story for Iron Man is actually the same origin story that was from the 1960s, but they transform it to reflect the Middle East, because the United States is at war in the Middle East. And they do the same thing in the comics as well. But other things associated with the comic books, they remain firmly rooted in the 1960s origins. So at some very basic level, comic books remain a kind of landscape that is adapting to the broader questions that are facing the United States. And we remain intrigued, or at least I remain intrigued, in trying to understand how that mediation and sort of negotiation with the aspirations associated with the American experience are being reflected in the pages and characters of comic books. So I will leave you with that. Thank you. So I think I have a little bit of time for a question, if you have a question.
And if anyone does have questions, please come up and ask them into the microphone.
The comic book code authority officially ended in the late 90s, but it was effectively over, it might even been the early 2000s. Many of the most socially important comic book stories, like the drug story and Spider-Man, that was run without the comics code. And so what happened was that the comics code remained in effect, but people were willing to ignore it, because the reason the comics code was important is because people believed if you didn't have the comics code sealed on your comic book, you wouldn't be able to sell it. So the second something sold without that on it, it immediately started to lose authority. But it did go into the early 2000s, but now it's officially gone, right? Now it's officially gone. Because of course the median age of comic book readers now is like 33. 43 probably, depending on who you ask. So yes, it remained in existence, but it was not enforced vigorously at the end. In fact, when they announced that it was officially over, people were like, I thought it was already dead. In the period that the comics were being created, it was a pretty sexist and racist period. So it was easier to introduce Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman was introduced in 1942, but she was a member of the Justice League, but she was the secretary of the Justice League. It was only in her own comic book that she had her own adventures. There were a number of female characters in the 1940s, Phantom Lady, Miss Fury. The 1940s had a large number of female characters, but in fact, one of the sort of tropes of the 1940s in film and television and comics is it was fine for women to go off and have all these adventures, but once they got married and had a kid, they stopped, right? So before that, they could do any number of things. Like they could be spies, they could be gunslingers, blah, 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 blah. But there's always this assumption that, oh, once they get married, they'll stop. This is why Wonder Woman had a boyfriend in Steve Trevor, although she was constantly saving him. There was an assumption, like they put that in there just so people would assume that one day Wonder Woman will get married after she has her adventures. With black characters, people are just racist and they didn't want to have black characters. It's only because the civil rights movement had reached such a high watermark, right? It's after the 1965 Voting Rights Act and after the 1964 Civil Rights Act, Marvel introduces the Black Panther, the first black character. DC will introduce its first black character in 1977 with his own comic book, right? You might have a character that appear in comics as a sort of supporting character. But it's basically racism and sexism that makes them resistant to introducing the character. And very quickly, characters start to evolve as the political landscape starts to evolve, even in the 70s. In the Fantastic Four, Sue Storm was referred to as the Invisible Girl. In the 70s, she's the Invisible Woman. And by the 80s, she's like the most powerful member of the team. Like she can do any number of things. In the first issue of the story, in the first sort of run of Fantastic Four, she would often faint if she had to do something really complicated. Like she couldn't be invisible, do a force field, move something without fainting. Right, and this was common for a lot of characters in female characters in 1960s, they would faint. By the 70s, no fainting, right? You can't faint, no fainting.
By the 80s, they were better with the guns and guns.
Yes, by the 80s, they were better at all that stuff. By the 80s, the Invisible Woman could kill you from like half a world away. She can make a little air bubble appear in your brain, you have an aneurysm and die. Like she was the worst, she was the best character ever. But at least she was also kind of scary. Like, well, you know, I don't know if that's a good thing. She's a killer. But she's super strong, right? Like, I mean, they've really sort of played up the fact that, like, well, she's really the strongest character, because now she can, like, lift a building, cook a cake, say something to the kids and all that, and be invisible at the same time. Like, she can do like 18 different things. Multitasking, taking too far. Yeah.
I just saw this on Comic Book Men. Stan Lee was on.
Sure.
And of course, this goes right there to why he created Dr. Doom the way he did. Because of the code, he said that he had to come up with a villain that could get away. So,
diplomatic immunity.
Yeah, Dr. Doom is not a criminal because it's not a crime to want to take over the world.
Right.
And that was his angle. But I'm shocked that you didn't bring up the graphic novel The Moss.
Yeah.
Because that was like a big movement. He was like really big right after World War II. Because he illustrated the whole World War II through mice. So there was like no.
Yeah, that comes out in the 1970s. That he was one of the contributors to Arcade. Yeah, there are a number of graphic novels that come out in the 70s. Just for the sake of time, I didn't mention all of them. Mouse is probably the most famous one. But really, many of the stories that are Mouse are actually, they appear in Raw, which is another kind of companion publication to Arcade. And those comics aren't aimed for kids and are collected later and become sort of literary. Because the comic books penetrate into the bookstore, Mouse and other sort of like long form graphic narratives become part of the sort of bookstore avenue. So we don't necessarily think of them as part of the comic industry.
I'm just curious because I know that's a
yeah. In fact, Mouse is one of the ones that are on most of the teaching. Right, people teach 3 graphic novels without fail. They teach The Watchmen. They teach Mouse, and then they just teach The Dark Knight Returns. Right, yes. Mouse has won a Pulitzer. It's very important. But when you do something like this, you're forever gonna leave something out. I didn't talk about like Luke Cage, and that was wrong. Like Luke Cage was the first black superhero with on the cover of Mouse. It had it on Max superhero story. Like, man. Like, oh yeah. I didn't talk about Miss Fury, Phantom Lady. I should have. But.
Well, let's have one more round of applause for Julian Chambliss. Julian, thank you so much.